I'll start on the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give of the shape that we were in. And just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. And that sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. So come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be saved. To the table.
All who failed, you've been forgiven. All who dream and all who suffer. All who loved and lost another. All the chained and all the free. All who follow, all who lead. Anyone who's been let down. All the lost, you have been crowned. All who've been labeled right or wrong. To everyone who hears this song. Join the sinners, you have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. To the table.
Hey, good morning, everybody. You are welcome here this day. Come to the table. Come and feast. Come and be with the Lord this day. I'm excited to worship with you. Our mission here at Westminster is to elevate Jesus, to empower people, and to embody his love when we leave here today. And we hope that this time will inspire you to do just that, to meet with God, to be empowered by him, and to go and to love the world. I've got a couple of things for you. I just want to point out the bulletin that you picked up, hopefully on the way in. Inside of that bulletin, there's a little card that looks like this. Is that in there? Is that a drop-in for everybody? If not, if this isn't in there, sorry, I was confused on one thing. This isn't in there. You have a connection card, and it talks about the thing that I'm holding. So on Tuesday, Monday. Oh my goodness, man, let's just start over. So welcome everybody, we're glad you're here today. So in your bulletin you have a connection card, and whether you're new or attended here many times, we want you to pick that up. There is an event in there on your connection card that we would need your feedback on. And so every year, Love Inc., we partner with them a lot in our town. They host a banquet, and so that is Monday, November the 22nd this year. And on your connection card, there's a chance to check a box that says you would like room at the table that we've signed up for at that banquet. That's what I was trying to say. Thanks for being patient with me. All right, so make sure you check that out and drop that in the offering plate a little bit later in the service. For now, let's stand and greet one another. Find somebody that you may not know and pass the peace. Let them know that God is with them in this place. All right, if you'll remain standing, stay standing for me. We're going to go into our call to worship here. We're doing this a little bit different this morning. So we're actually going to divide the room in two parts. So if you're on this side of the room, that is the east side, you're going to be with Carrie here. If you're on this side of the room over here, you're on the west side and you're going to read with me. We're going to kind of have a little bit of call back and forth for our call to worship today. So Carrie, go ahead and lead the east side off and we'll follow you.
Call to worship today is based on Psalm 34. I will bless God every chance I get. My lungs will expand with his praise.
I live and breathe God. When things aren't going well, I remind myself of my God.
Join me in spreading the news. Together, let's get the word out.
God met me more than halfway. He freed me from my anxious fears.
Look at him and let your heart shine. Never hide your feelings from him.
When I was desperate, I called out, and God brought me out of a tight spot.
God's angel sets up a circle of protection around those who call on him.
Don't just wonder about God. Experience him. Open your mouth and taste the banquet of our God's goodness. Blessed are all who run to him. Let's worship God.
We have come to join in worship and adore the Lord our God. Let us come
himself will rise and
Please join me in the prayer of confession. God our Father, in your Son Jesus, you lay out an extravagant banquet of your mercy and grace. But we often make excuses, choosing instead to eat alone, scraping together the leftovers of our own efforts. Forgive us for neglecting your hospitality and for neglecting others who are also invited into your sumptuous feast. Turn us into people who indulge deeply in your grace, who revel in the salvation party you are hosting.
Let's sing Jesus Christ, you are my one desire.
In Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. My one desire, my one desire. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. My one desire, my one desire. I wanna know you more. I wanna love you more. I wanna hunger more for you. I wanna know you more. I wanna love you more. I wanna hunger more for you.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. My one desire, my one desire. In Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. My one desire, my one desire.
Even in the valley,
even in the valley of the shadow of death, you remain the same. You will never change.
That's good news.
Even when the battle rages, you're right next to me.
Yes, he is.
You will never leave. You're the reigning king.
Sing it again.
And even in the valley of the shadow of death, oh, you remain the same. You will never change. And even when the battle rages, you're right next to me. Oh, you will never leave. You're the reigning king.
I wanna know you more. I wanna love you more. I wanna hunger more for you. Yes, that's our prayer, God.
I wanna love you more. I wanna love you more. I wanna hunger more for you. And even in the valley of the shadow of death, you remain the same, and you will never change. And even when the battle rages, you're right next to me. You will never leave. You're the reigning king.
Save your friend.
And save your friend. You are my one desire. My one desire. My one desire.
Is that your prayer, church?
Save your friend, you are my one desire. My one desire.
One more time.
My one desire.
Sing it again.
And save your friend. You are my one desire. My one desire. My one desire. Save your friend. You are my one desire. My one desire. My one desire.
Yes, God, that is our prayer. That you would reign on your throne. And that we would come and worship at your feet. Amen. All right, church, you can have a seat. And kids, y'all come on down front. We got a message for you, just like every week. If you're in elementary school or younger, often those are the kids who come down. Some of our middle schoolers join. Anyone who wants to, y'all, come on down, kids. And Bob's going to chat with you this morning.
Hi. All right. Thanks for coming down. So this might seem a little bit early, but really not really, because it always applies. You know that next Sunday is the Sunday before Thanksgiving, right? Thanksgiving is kind of a big deal for most people, at least in our, you know, in our country and stuff like that. But we always have meals. You probably had a meal this morning, right? You had breakfast, you're going to have lunch, have dinner. And sometimes those are just regular, ordinary meals. Sometimes those are really special meals, right? Sorry? I don't know. I have a friend who has an elf on the shelf. Yeah. Okay. All right. That's that. We're looking forward to that season too, aren't we? So it's really important to me that wherever you are, whether it's a big fancy meal or whether it's a, you know, just eating Cap'n Crunch, right? That you have good manners. So that's really important. So help me out here. I just want to go over a few things. It's just good once in a while to review these things, right? So one manner that's really important is don't chew with your mouth full, right? So it's just really important not to chew with your
like this.
All right. All right. So, kids, don't chew with your mouth full. Okay. So, when you're sitting at the table, you're sitting in a chair, you don't tip back in your chair and just kind of lean back. You keep all four legs of the chair on the floor, right?
Oh, I love Thanksgiving, Bob.
That's what happens.
Because you could fall backwards, right?
Put my head on the ground when I feel
bad. Yeah, I know. That's why we do it. So, here's another one. Here's a question. And when you're at the table, do you put your elbows on the table, or do you not put your elbows on the table?
Just like this. That's great.
All right, Andrew. I'm trying to talk to the kids here, all right? All right. Yes.
One time I was at school, and I was leaning sideways the wrong way in my chair, and
yep.
I tipped over, and I almost cracked my head open.
Oh, my goodness. Let's not do that. That's exactly why we're doing this. That's right. So interrupting is another thing. When you're at the table and somebody's talking,
I would never interrupt you. I would never do that.
You know, end of the year reviews are coming up.
Oh.
So just, all right. So if the potatoes are on the other side of the table, do you just reach across the table and grab the potatoes?
No.
What do you do? You can wait and hope that they come around to you eventually, right? They probably will. Or you can say, please pass the potatoes, right? Somebody will pass them to you? No, you don't throw the potatoes. You just wait and somebody will pass you the dish. Okay. Okay, things are... Don't put potatoes in your ears. That's right. That's why we're doing this. Okay. If you have a glass of milk and there you have a straw in it, should you blow bubbles in the... That's actually one that I think is okay. So if your parents have a problem with that, they should send a letter to Andrew. Okay. So there's all kinds of manners, right? Things that we think of as being polite. And it's for good reason, because we want to respect the people that we're sitting at the table with, right? So we're going to hear a story today. It's really an awesome story about Jesus going to dinner at somebody's house. And there were manners that were important then, too. Some of them were kind of different from the manners that we know. And Jesus introduces, I don't know if Jesus blew bubbles in his milk, but maybe he did. Anyway, Jesus tells some new manners, right? Some new rules that reflect what's really important to him. Okay? So let's listen for that. God just doesn't want us just to be polite. God wants us to reflect what he's like, to love the things that God loves. So be listening really close for that, because God loves you. So let's pray. God, thank you that you care about how we live. And whether it's table manners, but even more importantly, just the way that we treat others and the way that we relate to you. Help us to learn from that today, from a surprising story that Jesus tells. And thank you that you love us and you invite us to your table. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Awesome. Let's stand and sing Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me.
Our scripture reading today is from Luke 14, 1 through 14. Please listen for God's living word. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. There in front of him was a man suffering from abnormal swelling of his body. Jesus asked the Pharisees and the experts in the law, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they remained silent, so taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him on his way. Then he asked them, "If one of you has a child or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull it out?" And they had nothing to say. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come to you and say to you, "Give this person your seat." Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, "Friend, move up to a better place." Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. God, we give you permission now to speak to us through this word that is read and proclaimed, and we pray that you would find a way to get inside of us, for us to hear your word afresh, to hear what it's really saying, to change us from the inside out. God, we look forward to this, and we pray that you do it by your Holy Spirit, and we know you will, because we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. It's good to see you. Think of one of the most memorable, most wonderful meals that you've ever had. Just go with the one that first comes to your mind. And I bet there was great food and great things to drink and a wonderful atmosphere. But I bet that even more than that, you associate it with who you were with, right? And that just makes everything better. and maybe I'm sure it's very memorable. I'd love to hear some of your stories, and after worship today, after the sermon, you can just share those stories with each other. It's really interesting. One of the most memorable meals in my life happened on the ground behind a trailer house in the middle of nowhere, northern New Mexico. I'd love to tell you that story sometime. One of the greatest meals of my life. Meals tell a story, don't they? I mean, it's not just what we ingest into our bodies and how wonderful and delicious that might be. They tell a story of where we are and who we're with and the significance of that time. And we remember, we've talked about this several times so far in our series through the Gospel of Luke, that important things happen at meals. It's happened many times now. Jesus reveals things about himself and about his purpose and about us. Excuse me. Table. And that means when people are invited to the same table, it means acceptance. We talked about this last week. It means welcome. It means I want an intimate time with you. It means I want to enjoy this meal together with you. It's so significant. We usually don't think about it that much, but in that culture, at that time especially, very, very significant who ate with whom. Did any of you ever grow up? That's not what I meant to say. I know you did. Did any of you grow up in a town that had a small town newspaper where people, there was a column in the newspaper of who invited whom over to eat? Did that make you very careful about who you invited over to eat? My wife grew up in a town like that, and wow, wow. Significant, right? Who's associating with whom? Not next Sunday, but two Sundays after that, on December 5th, we'll have a potluck lunch after worship on the December 5th. And that's a wonderful time, but we've missed that kind of thing so much during this challenging pandemic time. But we'll, if you're ready to do that, come and enjoy that meal. The chili cook-off a couple weeks ago was so wonderful. I was robbed of the trophy, but that's okay. I'm over it. But it's just so great to sit around the table together. God does amazing things at the table. Jesus is invited to the home of a prominent Pharisee. Not just a Pharisee, a prominent Pharisee. And you can be sure that there were important people around the table. See, that culture, it's a little bit hard for us to relate to. It was a very much an honor-shame culture. Your honor was very important. And if you felt dissed or shamed by someone, that was a very deep wound. And one of the ways that someone was honored was to have honorable people around them. So if you were throwing a dinner, and this happened to be a Sabbath dinner, a very important dinner, you wanted to, if you could, you wanted to invite the most impressive guest list that you could. And this was a prominent Pharisee, so you can be sure that there were important, wealthy, influential, even famous people around you at the table, including Jesus. Jesus was probably considered the guest of honor, preacher, this prophet that everybody was talking about was invited to the table, and everybody wanted to see what he was going to say and do. In fact, they set a trap for this famous prophet who came to dinner. It was a Sabbath, and we've seen this before in Luke's gospel. Jesus comes, and there, and Luke points it out, right in front of him is this person with dropsy, a condition of edema, swelling throughout his whole body. That made him unclean, for one thing. Made him undesirable. Not like any of the guests. One of these things is not like the other. It was that man. And they wanted to see what Jesus was going to do. And we've already seen what Jesus does on the Sabbath for people who need wholeness. Right? He reaches out. He takes hold of the man. That's pretty aggressive. He takes hold of the man, heals him, and sends him on his way. We've seen this before. Jesus is not afraid to bring wholeness on the Sabbath. In fact, that's what the Sabbath is all about. That's what Jesus is all about. But Luke doesn't spend much time on that. That happens. He goes away. The important guests are silent. So they're like, let's see where this goes. And where it goes is not pretty. This should be a reminder to them and would be to anybody, be careful about inviting Jesus to dinner. Because Jesus then launches into an unsolicited lecture for his host and the other guests. Talk about an awkward dinner. Jesus notices that people are taking seats of honor. Remember, this is an honor-shame culture, and there were very prescribed, very specific rules, much more than what we were just joking with the kids about who sat where and the importance of those seats. The closer you were to the host, obviously, the more important your spot was, and therefore the more important you were, and therefore that much glory reflected upon the host who was so fortunate to have such a prominent person sitting close to them. Does it all sound a little bit stilted and silly? We do the same thing, just in different ways, right? So Jesus notices how these people are just jockeying for position, and it's all about self-promotion. It's all about broadcasting by all these cultural signals who they were and how important they were. And you know, I don't think I have to tell you, but I will, that self-promotion is just such a big part of our modern life. I mean, think of all the ways that we subtly communicate to people, you should think highly of me. I saw a Facebook post on Veterans Day, and we're grateful for veterans, and this person posted thank you to all those veterans out there, but the picture had nothing to do with Veterans Day. It was like a glamour shot of this person. Like, look how pretty I am. Happy Veterans Day, everybody. Like, what doesn't fit there? And that was kind of a crazy example, but we do it all the time. And not to just pick on the easy target, but social media just sets us up like crazy to promote ourselves, right? Like, look at me. Look at all the fun I'm having. Look at the great vacation I'm taking. Look at how pretty I am, how handsome I am, how rich I am. I mean, all these ways that we promote ourselves, and we do it all the time in our culture. This banquet that the prominent Pharisee threw was a banquet for winners, people who really were somebody. Really had, they of course they were invited because they expected to be invited because they were such impressive people. So Jesus calls them out on that. Like, sit down here. It's better to have a pleasant surprise than an unpleasant surprise, right? That kind of makes sense. Then Jesus, as if that weren't enough, then he launches into, like, and another thing. Look at who you invited. I mean, here's the mayor, and here's the banker, and here's the editor of the newspaper, and here's all, you know, take your pick, right? And just all these important people who can really get things done, people look up to, they're, you know, the A-list. Jesus is like, why didn't you invite my friends? You invited me. Why didn't you invite the prostitutes and the poor and the lepers and the foreigners and the refugees and the outcast? Why didn't you invite my friends? And everybody's like, this is awkward. Just that you could cut the tension in the air with a knife. And then, and I personally think that this is kind of funny in kind of a sad way, to break the silence, somebody who's just heard Jesus talk about the resurrection, I think probably because he had already had a little bit too much to drink, raises his cup for a toast. To break this awkward silence, and he says, and this is verse 15, he says, blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. In that time, there were expectations of a coming messianic banquet. And it goes all the way back to, 7-8 centuries before, where God was planting this desire in his people, and prophets like Isaiah, like in Isaiah chapter 25, were writing about what this banquet would be like, and it was a banquet that was going to celebrate God's victory. When God finally entered the stage again and defeated Israel's enemies and made things right and made things the way they were supposed to be again, and there would be this messianic, eschatological, end times banquet about what God had accomplished to save his people. And over the centuries since Isaiah started talking about that, the expectations for that banquet started to change. They started to become more exclusive. They started to become more self-serving. And around the time that Jesus lives, the community in Qumran, by the Dead Sea, the place where the Dead Sea Scrolls come from, had a writing about expectations for this messianic banquet where there would be no Gentiles at the banquet, no way. There would be no sinners. There would be no one who was defiled or unclean in any way, and there would be no handicapped people. Those are the people who are undesirable and will not be welcome at the banquet. When that inebriated man lifted up the cup and proposed that toast, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God," that, I bet you anything, is what he was thinking. He was looking around at all the impressive, beautiful people around him, and he was saying, "Here it is, folks. This banquet right here. The messianic banquet is going to be just like this, and blessed are we." And Jesus is like, "All right. You want to go there? I have a story to tell you." He tells a parable. Let me just pause for a second and remind us about parables. A parable is a story that sticks with you. It's not simply X equals this, Y equals this, and therefore Z equals this. It's a story that engages our imagination. A story that can be subversive, a story that can really mess with us and get inside of us. And that's exactly what Jesus wants to do. It is not just about teaching a simple lesson or a nice little moral like don't blow bubbles in your milk. Just wanted to share with you this wonderful quote I came across this week from a New Testament scholar named Klein Snodgrass. Nobody names their kids Clyde Snodgrass anymore. He says, because parables were indirect communication, right? He says, direct communication is important for conveying information, but learning is more than information intake, especially if the learning is for someone who already thinks they understand. People entrenched in their current understanding set their defenses against direct communication and end up conforming the message into the channels of their current understanding of reality. But indirect communication finds a way in through the back window. In other words, if you are convinced that reality is this way, and somebody tells you directly, "No, it's not," what are you going to do? I think we all know this by now. We're going to dig in our heels. Even against all evidence to the contrary, we're going to dig in our heels. But Jesus teaches parables because that's different. He's not teaching them. He's not directly correcting them. He's telling a story that will get inside of us and change us. So I'm going to pick up reading from verse 16. Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, 'I have just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me.' Another said, 'I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me.' Still another said, 'I just got married, so I can't come.' The servant came back and reported this to the master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.' 'Sir,' the servant said, 'what you have ordered has been done, but there is still room.' Then the master told the servant, 'Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet.'" Wow. You may have heard attention drawn to these excuses before. These people have excuses not to come to the master's banquet. Remember, this is a parable. This is a story, a multifaceted story that Jesus is telling. And I was reading this week about some real doozies, some excuses that people have given for why they can't come into work. And I wanted to share a couple of these with you because I thought they were really precious. One, a person actually said this, wrote this in, a cow broke into my house and I have to wait for the insurance adjuster. Another person said, a relative of mine is being exhumed for a police investigation. Possible. Another person said, I woke up in a good mood and I didn't want to ruin it, so I'm not coming into work. And then another person wrote, the ozone in the atmosphere flattened my tires. I can't come to work. Like, those are really, really, really silly. One person says to the messenger of the host, I just bought a field. Another person says, I just bought some oxen. Another person said, I just got married. And I don't know if those sound like lame excuses to you or not, but consider that in Deuteronomy chapter 20, in the law of Moses, there are three valid reasons for avoiding conscription in the Israeli army. Guess what they are? Property, agriculture, and being a newlywed. So it seems pretty clear that Jesus was winking when he was telling this story. People knew that those were the three loopholes for getting out of service. Jesus isn't pointing out what bad excuses these are. He's actually saying what good excuses these are. But even the very best excuses, which we're going to hear more from in the next passage next week, even the very best excuses aren't good enough, because there's nothing that should be a higher priority than coming to the banquet from this host to which you have been invited. There's no excuse that's good enough. Not even the worst one, not even the best one. To say no to that invitation is exalting yourself. And we know what Jesus said about exalting. Those who exalt themselves will be humbled, but those who humble themselves will be exalted. It is exalting yourself to say, you know what, that sounds nice. That sounds like a great banquet. Thank you ever so much for the invitation, but I kind of got other stuff going on. And it's really valid stuff. I could show you chapter and verse where it is, so I'm not going to go. But in this honor-shame culture, that is a terrible insult. If you invited somebody to your birthday party or a very special event that you were throwing, and a person said, you know what, that sounds great, thanks, by the way, happy birthday, but I kind of consider you as optional, and so therefore I won't be coming. Ouch! That's what these people are saying to the master's invitation. Like, sounds great, I'd rather not. So Jesus is saying that there is no priority that should override the urgency and the importance of this invitation to come to the banquet. And speaking of the banquet, I think you're wondering this, what does that mean? What is this banquet that he's talking about? You know, it's a parable, right? So we're supposed to kind of gaining some insight from this, like what's he actually talking about? And this might sound strange to you, but the banquet that Jesus is talking about is not heaven, at least not primarily. He's not talking about who is going to be able to come to finally come into heaven when they die at the very end of things. That's my banquet. Some of you will make it, some of you won't. That's not the main thrust of what he's saying. The banquet is a relationship with the host that begins and is available now. And you've heard me say this before. Dallas Willard once said, why on earth would you want to spend eternity with someone you've spent your whole life trying to avoid? The banquet is to enter into the host's friendship, the host's hospitality, the host's resources for you, the host's joy in being able to share his riches with you. That's the banquet that you are invited into, you and me, today. And if that's not true, then the heaven part doesn't even make any sense. You are invited to this banquet. As one person said, all the way to heaven is heaven. If you're not going to begin to enjoy that now, you're certainly not going to enjoy it later. And it's interesting, Jesus points out, and Andrew got into this in last week's passage, the host doesn't uninvite anybody, doesn't reject anybody, but they are free to uninvite themselves. And that happens when we exalt ourselves, because then we will be humbled. So remember what the man says at the banquet, this comical scene. This man manages to get to his feet, and he's getting drunker during this whole sermon. You notice that? And he lifts up the glass, and he says, "Blessed is the one who will eat in the feast of the kingdom of God." He thinks the banquet looks just like that. And Jesus is like, "Oh no, it's nothing like this. I'm done with this party. You want to know what the real party is like? Invite people who don't deserve to be there. This is not a banquet for the A-list. It's not a banquet for people who would suppose that they deserve to be there. So when I was in college, back in the Eisenhower administration, just kidding, the Reagan administration, I met this man. Some of you, this might be a familiar face. He is a congressman from the 26th District of Texas, but he went to college in Jamestown, North Dakota. Anybody from Jamestown, North Dakota? I know one. Went to college in Jamestown, where I was fortunate enough to go to college. And he established this program where students from Jamestown could come to Washington for a winter to be an intern with him and to learn what all that stuff was about. And I was able to do this. So I was got to know Richard Armory, close personal friend of mine. Not really. But he was the House Majority Leader for a while, very powerful, brilliant man, PhD in economics. And it was the time when Ronald Reagan was leaving office and George H.W. Bush was coming in. We were during that time, that January. And Dick Armey was famous for just calling out all the crazy excesses that were going on in Washington. And the Bush inauguration was going to cost millions and millions and millions of dollars, and he was just disgusted by all that. And so he had his tickets to the inauguration events, including inauguration balls. And he gave them, well, it was me and my friend, he gave them to us. And he said, "Here are my tickets, VIP tickets to all these events." He said, this is dumb. I'm not going to go. You go." Like, all right. And we had a fabulous time. I mean, we were the beneficiaries of all these millions and millions and millions of dollars that were spent on this inauguration. I met George Bush myself. No, I didn't. But it was fancy, and we were like showing up at places where people were pulling up in limousines and wearing tuxedos, and we were wearing Jamestown College sweatshirts. We weren't in that crowd, but we had the tickets. And we went to the inauguration events and had a fabulous, fabulous time. The kingdom that Jesus is talking about is a little bit like that. It's not for the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame, just because it's good to be poor, crippled, blind, and lame. It's because those people have nothing to stand on. They're complete outcasts in this society. And in this banquet, there are no outcasts. Nobody earns their way into this banquet. It is completely because of a gift from a very generous host who invites people in to relationship with him. It's not about status. And Jesus, I think that's one of the things that Jesus is hammering home. Listen, all I see around me at this banquet, you guys, is just status. self-seeking status, the kingdom that I'm about, the banquet that I'm throwing, the party that I'm putting on is not about status at all. You cannot be good enough to earn it. You cannot be bad enough to shake it. It is a gift. The only status we have, Jesus says, is me. You have my status. Andrew talked last week about the narrow gate and what a troubling passage that is. And it is a troubling passage. But it's not about earning your way into the narrow gate, is it? What if the narrow gate is Jesus himself? He's the one who says, if you want to come into this party, come on in. Here's the door. You are welcome here. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Just think back to what Mary sang in the Magnificat. She said exactly the same thing. People who are welcome at this banquet are people who have no credentials to force their way in or be accepted. Just the grace of the host himself. Long before we get to Easter, God is raising the dead. So what does this mean for us? One of the things it means is for us to examine, are we making excuses? And I'm just not talking about attendance at church. But to this banquet of relationship that God is extending, do we make excuses? Too busy, I got other priorities. I mean, those are the low-hanging fruit. It's easy to think of those. But what if you think to yourself, well, you know what? I'm poor. Maybe not materially poor, maybe so. But I'm poor. I'm a poor character. Or I'm crippled and lame. I've been hurt by others. I've been hurt by other Christians. I've been hurt by the church. That's my excuse. Or I'm blind. I just don't see how any of this pertains to me at all. I don't see what a difference any of this God stuff could make. What excuses might you add to that? But Jesus says, as I think he says to the man with dropsy, you are the guest of honor. Friend, move up. You're free from all the social jockeying and all the subtle games that we play with each other and with God. You're free from that. There's no bookkeeper here. The other thing that I think that means for us today is for those who hear the host's voice, he says, go out. Go out. Don't just wait for other people to happen to find their way in. Go out and find them, whoever they are, because my house is going to be full. I have such a party to throw. I have so much to share, so much to give. There's not going to be anything wasted. Bring people in. And you've heard us talking about it, but that speaks to us as a congregation. That's WPC's mission. I mean, we nurture one another. We are cared for in community here. We are always working at that. But we need to go out. We need to find people who need to know this host and to invite them not just to church, but to invite them into our lives, to invite them to our table, to invite them to friendship, to invite them to the character that Jesus is building into us so that they can see the source of those good gifts. You know, we're hiring this director of family ministry. It's going to add 10% to our budget. That's a big step. But it's in obeying Jesus to go out and draw people into his banquet. That's why we're doing it. So in a couple weeks, there's this, you might have your own Thanksgiving plans. That's great. But there's this 31st annual Westminster Thanksgiving meal at Camp Rimrock on Thanksgiving Day at 1 o'clock. What if that meal had complete strangers, from our city sitting at the table. Just as a concrete example. What if you were to begin inviting the people who live near you? They say everybody has a close circle of about 8 to 15 people. What if you just started inviting them into your life? Come on over for dinner. Or let's go to the Millstone. Or it's Taco Tuesday. You know, whatever it is. Invite people into your life. I think Jesus means what he says. Invite people who are not going to pay you back. Just as a sign of the kingdom, as a sign of the way that you have been loved, to extend that love to other people. And I'm sure that you can think of other ways that this applies to you. If you just let this parable sink in, let it come in through the back window, let it mess with you and change your assumptions and change the way you think, God will be glorified. Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. I want to invite the ushers to come and receive the offering. You may or may not have a financial gift to share today. That's another matter. But there are cards in the backs of the pews that offer you another way to offer something else that God is stirring in your life. In either case, let's take this time to offer our lives to God.
Go ahead and join with me in this first stanza.
As we gather at your table, as we listen to your word, help us know, oh God, your presence. Let our hearts and minds be stirred. Nourish us with sacred story till we claim our own. Teach us through this holy banquet how to make love's victory known.
Y'all stand and sing. Turn our worship.
Turn our worship into witness in the sacrament of life. Send us forth to love and serve you, bringing peace where there is strife. Give us, Christ, your great compassion to forgive as you forgave. May we still behold your image in the world you died to save. Gracious Spirit, help us summon other guests to share that feast, where triumphant love will welcome those who had been last in least. And fear no more will envy bind us, nor will pride our peace destroy. Join with saints and angels to repeat the sounding joy. There no more will envy bind us, nor will pride our peace destroy. As we join with saints and angels to repeat the sounding joy.
Please pray with me. God, we turn to you because you have turned to us. you have extended the invitation of your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, your friendship, your acceptance, your love to us. God, forgive us for the ways that we prioritize other things over that. Thank you that your love for us is patient. God, we've made excuses, but your offer of grace just keeps coming at us. Help us not to squander that gift. Thank you, God, that you understand the circumstances that we might think of as excuses in our lives, but you also overcome them. Keep drawing us to yourself. God, help us to live by the new manners, the new rules, the new ethos of your kingdom, not to live in this world that is so much about self-seeking, but that we would seek you, and therefore that we would seek others as your sons and daughters. God, help us to not exalt ourselves, for we will be humbled, but to humble ourselves, not to be humiliated, but to understand that what you have given to us, everything you've given to us, comes completely as an undeserved gift. And therefore, we praise you, we thank you, we bless you, we stand in wonder, and we need you. God, we lift up the details, circumstances of our lives as we find ourselves confronted by this rich, fruitful story of Jesus. God, help us to be participants in this banquet. Help us to be residents of this kingdom as we go from here this week. We pray specifically today for Maxine Heffron and for Donna Anderson and for others that we name before you. God, this world is broken, but you are our healer. May that be true in us, so that your word would become true in us as we go to invite people into your banquet. God, we praise you. We lift up everything in our hearts to you. We thank you that you meet us. You welcome us. You say, friend, move up. We are honored in your sight, and we are amazed. Help us to live this week as your beloved sons and daughters. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please have a seat. Just want to mention a couple of things to you. I mentioned the Thanksgiving meal at Camp Rimrock, and I would challenge you, invite you, unless you have your own plans, or maybe you want to change your plans, to consider that meal and consider it as a ministry opportunity to reach out to other people. Next week and the following week, we will have Advent wreaths, if you don't have an Advent wreath, and other resources to participate in a meaningful Advent together. The 28th of November, the weekend after Thanksgiving, is the first weekend of Advent, if you can believe it. It's going to be a wonderful season. We're going to take a short break from our Luke series, and we're looking forward to that. Andrew is going to say a brief word about something you'll find in the lobby this morning.
May have noticed that on the lobby we've had this table where our youth are fundraising for our trips this summer, and yeah, they've got an order sheet out there for you to buy some stuff beforehand, and there are even pies that you could pick up next week. So November the 21st, if you want to pre-order a pumpkin pie this week, you'll be able to pick it up next Sunday before Thanksgiving. Man, let's get a whiff of that. That's not pumpkin. This is what I get for not using my table manners earlier. Order a pumpkin pie to make that worth it. Please go buy a pumpkin pie. They're going to be great, and there's plenty more that we can do to support you throughout Christmas if you're willing to go out there and support our youth. Thanks.
This need not be your fate. So. Receive this blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the guest who has become the host, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and the joy and the strength and the encouragement of the Holy Spirit be with you and flow through you now and always. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, one last thing before we sing our last song. Today is the last day, if you haven't, to pick up an Operation Christmas Child box. They are due next Sunday and no later. Okay? So thank you if you would like to participate in that. God bless you.
Of God.